Sammy Adams, Lazy Boy, Matty Trump, yeah, Boston stand up, we got 'em. Oh, oh, oh,
baby.
Thank you. Well, this is Cam Mullen from Camelback Music. I'm here with my friend Sammy Adams.
What's up, brother?
Doing well. So, Sammy, start to stop. You start off producing I Hate College, your remix to Asher Roth. The next thing you know, you're blowing up number one on iTunes. What's that like to, you know, outdo 99% of the upcoming artists in the game?
It was dope. Unexpected.
Yeah.
Which makes it that much better, because, you know, it's like, just hits you, it's like,
for sure.
When I was like on a plane with my manager, and we were like looking at iTunes, and we were like top 10. And then we landed and we were like number 3, and then like, the next couple of days we were like number 1. And it was just like,
really?
It just seemed like it was so real. It's
a lot. And what about last night? I actually checked out Barstool Sports. I heard you got in some trouble last night. You got arrested at a Kansas State show.
Yes, sir.
What's the story there?
I was on stage. Our noise permit got pulled, I guess. We didn't get notified.
You started a riot or something?
Yeah, that's what they said. That's what I accused of. Basically, I didn't know our permit got pulled, and then we tried to do Drive Me Crazy, and the beginning of Drive Me Crazy, I just got cuffed on stage and taken
off. Yeah, you
fucking sucked.
I guess so. But in your music, you've really blown up in the college scene. You've been touring everywhere. I hear you're on a 31-day tour, basically.
Yeah, like 34, 45 years.
Yeah, that's nuts. So what do you think it's going to take to really get to, like, to start becoming mainstream and really get on MTV and, you know, really get on all the hit radio stations?
It depends. A lot of it's politics. A lot of it's who you know. A lot of it's who you're signed to, which is a problem for me. So it takes that much more hard work and perseverance, because you're constantly getting knocked down and said no to it. So you always have to, you know, sort of come up with new things, new ways to catch people's attention, like that go beyond like the conventional ways of like music videos and sounds and shit and shit. You know, most people only get into music for physical. Most artists on radio don't have music.
What about those music videos you've been making, huh? Those, what are those like filming? Are they just...
They're fun, right? Like, the last one, you know, the last one we did, Just Saying,
yeah, Nantucket.
It was so natural. My boy filmed it. And it was basically just like us on the beach, like doing what we do, us at like my old buddy's house, like on the roof, like raising and drinking, just hanging out. Nothing was staged, like, you go stand here, you do this, you do that, like... The more natural it is, the more natural it comes out on film. Sometimes that's good for like MTV and stuff. Sometimes it's like a little too
casual,
a little too like, you know, unconventional, like I said. But it was like, it's crazy. Making music videos and stuff is nuts, because like it's a huge process. Like, wardrobe, makeup, models. Locations,
sure. And you've been going to Nantucket for a while. Is that kind of your summer spot?
Yeah, I fucking love
that
place.
What's it like in the summers?
It's dope. It's just
house party,
big shit party. Show, you know. I started going when I was like 19 or 20. Back when I was like using my boys on the game, shit.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's dope. It's a hell summer spot. One time you're like, yeah, my boys, all the way together, so it's crazy.
I was wondering this, like, what about the girls in your music videos? And like, Drive Me Crazy, you're back in some room with some girl. Then you're on stage and you're like just rapping and some girls all over. Do you actually know those girls, or do you kind of just meet them right before you start?
Those girls are just models. For the most part,
it's pretty easy though.
There's some girls in Just Saying that are good friends. And it's fun because having them around is it's
pretty,
like,
yeah.
It's natural. So it's funny, like, in the scene where I like pick a girl up and she like dumps a beer on my head, like, that's a friend of mine.
Yeah. But, yeah. And what about, like, you know, there are a lot of upcoming rappers in the game, you know, a lot of white rappers, whether it's like a Hoodie Allen, On Cue, or any of those, or Webby. What do you think has really helped you to to really, you know, put yourself out there?
Crossing genres.
Yeah.
Sort of fan relations.
I mean, your genre isn't strictly hip hop. Huh? Yeah. It's kind of a hip hop, more like party, upbeat.
Hip hop, party, thing. Pop, techno, dubstep shit.
Yeah, you work with more dubstep now?
Yeah. It's just more like, you know, whatever I feel like doing, I'll do. I don't really want to box myself in. I think just what separates it is just, you know, like, basically just not having like a boundary. Like, well, yeah. I can't do that because that's too whatever.
Yeah.
It's too this. Too nah, yeah. It's too dancing. Like, I wouldn't be where I was at today if I was like, oh, I'm driving crazy, it's too dancing.
Yeah.
It's too
hard. No, sure.
So, just sort of expanding my boundaries and stuff. No shots to anyone, you know, that is doing their own thing in hip hop, but definitely crossing genres.
And what about the whole Sam App scandal where you're buying your own albums? How do you actually think, you know, all those rumors and stuff, how did that actually help you? You've talked about that before in other interviews.
It helped me, and it still sort of lingers. It's helped me in ways where a lot of people wouldn't have posted anything on their blog about me
if it wasn't really a scandal.
And then they did their research and were like, all right, this kid's all right.
How did that all start, do you know?
Yeah, we do know. Air me out. Fucking know who you are, snake ass motherfucker.
What you got coming up in the future? What can fans expect from you, you know?
Party Records drops in about 2.5 weeks.
Yeah?
And that's hosted by DJ Bukid and DJ Cash.
How many songs you have on
that? I think like 16 or 17. It's free. It's probably going to be distributed pretty much everywhere virally.
Are there any artists that you really hope to work with in the future?
In the future, for the record, we're really going to think hard about who to get on the record. People that I know I can vibe with.
Yeah.
So, you know, I know I can, you know, really just do my own thing. With being comfortable in the studio and people having respect for you while you're recording this makes a big fucking difference.
Anyway, I asked my buddy Woody Clemmer to try to ask some sorority sisters if they had any question to ask you, what would it be? And one girl came up and she said, she's like, oh, Sammy, if you could describe your dream girl, what would it be like trying to...
Wow, that's a tough one.
How would you respond to that?
Dream girl, huh?
Yeah.
Tall, maybe blonde, I have a nice ass. I'm not really a tick guy. But you need to have some tits.
Yeah.
But I'm an ass guy. You gotta be cool. Preferably smoke weed, no one roll. Don't be afraid of a good time. Be able to hang out with my boys when I'm not there. That's key.
Yeah.
And, you know, cool.
Yeah, you got
a lot.
I hear you. It's not... No easy list.
Not easy to come by. Yeah. I don't know what these Southern Bells are like, but.
Yeah, we'll find out tonight.
Northeast.
Anyway, we'll wrap it up. Thanks, man. I appreciate your time.
Yeah.